poet William Blake once wrote that to observe an eagle in flight is to see a portion of genius. Blake's praise could extend to any of the more than 10,000 different species of birds currently identified by science, for each embodies the highest levels of biological artistry and engineering. Yet while the world's appreciation of a sparrow, eagle, or owl is almost universal, one question still surrounds their remarkable aerial abilities. Is avian flight the result of some random, undirected process? Or was it designed by an intelligent agent for a magnificent purpose? Since the 19th century, science has focused primarily on the search for a purely materialistic explanation, most notably Darwinian evolution and the theory of natural selection. This perspective has given rise to multiple scenarios for the origin of flying birds. Many scientists now speculate that small dinosaurs gradually evolved feathers, wings, and powered flight over millions of years as they ran and jumped to flee predators, leaped from limb to limb in trees, or flapped feather-covered arms to catch flying insects. Each of these theories is highly controversial, and each contends that the true cause of flight is grounded in scientific materialism and the belief that matter and energy are all that exist in the universe.
From a materialist standpoint, you need some causal story, some account of how this unique function came to be. And, this is the critical point, you can't invoke a designer. No intelligence involved. Mind is excluded as a causal possibility. This assumption was captured eloquently by the Nobel laureate Francis Crick when he said, "Biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved."
It's so hard not to use language that suggests a purpose in biology, because everywhere we look, we see purpose and we see design. And yet we're told over and over, it just looks like it's full of purpose. It just looks like it's designed for a function.
There's a reason why a rule like that has to be imposed, because if it isn't, you're going to see that it's designed. That's what our brains logically tell us.
Intuitively, the appearance of design in nature is unmistakable, and opportunities to test its validity are woven throughout the network of biological systems that make avian flight possible. A prime example is a feather.
A bird's feathers are arranged to create a strong, highly efficient airfoil that produces lift as air moves rapidly over the curved top of the wing and slower beneath it. And as a consequence of that, there's a pressure differential. There's more pressure pushing up on the bottom of the wing than there is on top of the wing. So in a sense, a bird's actually sucked up into the air.
As a bird glides or flaps, a network of muscles, ligaments, and bones constantly adjust the position of its feathers to achieve the highest maneuverability. The inherent precision of this system is even more evident when the structure of a single feather is magnified.
One feather can contain a million individual parts, and its overall structure is supported by a hollow shaft that runs up the center. Then, branching out diagonally from the shaft, hundreds of strands called barbs give a feather its flexibility and aerodynamic shape. And when you move in closer, you see that each barb supports hundreds of even smaller structures called barbules.
Barbules are arranged into sets of opposing pairs. Those extending from one side of a barb support a cluster of microscopic hooks. And those on the other side are curled into ridges. As they overlap, the barbules interlock, hook to ridge, to create a zipper-like mechanism, and on a larger scale, a herringbone pattern that blocks the passage of air, bends freely, and allows a bird to easily repair breaks on the surface of its wings.
Unless those individual components that you see in feathers work together appropriately, you're simply not going to have a functional feather. And we need to remember that the feathers are just a small part of this overarching combination of systems that allow birds to fly.
The physical demands on a flying bird are severe, and dozens of biological systems are designed to meet every challenge. The enormous quantities of energy and strength a bird requires are produced by hearts that beat more than 500 times a minute. Massive breast muscles that relentlessly power their wings. The most efficient respiratory systems in the animal kingdom. And digestive systems designed to fuel high metabolisms without taxing the stringent weight requirements of flight. Birds also depend upon navigational systems that can track the sun, constellations, and the Earth's magnetic field. An internal gyroscope to stabilize the orientation of their bodies during rapid movements in the air. Enhanced vision to identify food from half a mile above the earth. And instinctive behaviors that cue and direct migration journeys across oceans and continents.
Obviously, you're coordinating many, many, many different systems that have to be all exactly right for the bird to fly. And the more systems and component parts that are involved, the more challenging it is to explain how all of them came together so precisely in a bird.
In human aviation, the design and integration of complex operational systems are hallmarks of foresight, purpose, and plan. But in a bird, could a purely materialistic process like natural selection account for the even higher levels of engineering required for flight?
No, and here's the problem. Natural selection is blind and unguided. It has no sense of direction, no sense of teleology is the big word that philosophers use. It doesn't know where it's going. The lack of foresight is the major problem. We know that if you throw all the parts for a 747 into the middle of a room and turn on a fan and blow everything around, you're not going to end up with a 747. We know it doesn't work that way intuitively, even when you've got all the parts. Organisms are much more complicated than a 747. Much more complicated, and they're integrated wholes. They're not the sum of their parts. They are alive and responsive, and in terms of multicellular organisms, how that would have happened, I haven't a clue, just by purely naturalistic means.
Here's the bottom line. You look at the anatomy of a bird, its behavior, its metabolism, the structure of its feathers, the structure of its muscles, and so forth. These are multiple independent points in a complex space, out of which flight emerges. And I think from a biological standpoint, to fly at all requires a cause that's able to visualize a distant functional endpoint and bring together everything necessary to achieve that endpoint. Uniquely and universally in our experience, only intelligence is capable of that kind of causal process.
An engineered system is the product of a mind that anticipated a problem and figured out a multi-step way of addressing that problem. In birds, you see exactly that kind of process. I believe that intelligent design is the best explanation for avian flight because it's the best explanation for every other kind of flight that we see. So why would I suddenly change the rules when I go from a 747 to a pigeon? They're engineering marvels. They're works of art. We know where engineered things come from. We know where works of art come from. So why would we attribute a bird to anything other than intelligence or mind?